So, hello, everybody. I'm going to talk to you about the rule of law and its complexities. At first sight, the rule of law is actually a fairly straightforward concept. On the surface, it simply means that there's a legal system which operates by its own rules, is not particularly political, and is accepted by the great majority of the citizens. It's administered by an independent judiciary. And classically, and by classically what I mean is that we have inherited a legal tradition from the Roman Empire, which has been elaborated. There's a separate tradition in the Anglo-Saxon world with overlaps and also dissimilarities. But basically, what the rule of law says is that the administration of the law should be as objective as possible. In other words, there should not be retroactive punishment. So if something was perfectly legal a week ago, you can't turn around and make it illegal now. Or alternatively, that the evidence on which a judgment is brought should be absolutely reliable. The integrity of evidence is absolutely crucial. There are serious problems with this, but I'll come on to that later. Furthermore, I think the rule of law also means that the legal tradition within which the law is administered is sustained by its own sense of professionalism. In other words, the judges should be professional, the lawyers should be professional, anybody involved with the law should have obviously a professional background, should know what they're talking about, and should have a commitment to administering the law as autonomously as possible. Now, here we come to a problem. If a legal system is simply too far from what the assumptions of society are, this becomes difficult because then it loses its legitimacy. It loses its respect if the courts bring in verdicts that the great majority of society regard as unjust. So in other words, there has to be some cautious, ongoing, continuous adjustment on the part of the legal world to what society expects. And of course, the legislative side of things, that's to say Parliament, where the political parties operate, will change the system all the time, which means that there's new legislation which has to be integrated into the legal system. This is perfectly normal. There's nothing untoward about this, nothing reprehensible. An interesting question is to what extent judges should abide by precedent. If one particular judge at one particular level has brought in a judgment, does that apply to all other judges? Well, in a way, the answer is both yes and no. Some legal systems simply disregard precedent, and I'll explain in a minute why. The Anglo-Saxon systems really go very strong on precedent, and they say if there is a precedent, especially if it's a precedent at the highest level. In my day, when I was studying law a long time ago, the highest level was the House of Lords. Today, it's the Supreme Court, or much the same. So if a judgment comes from the Supreme Court, then basically all other courts have to follow it. Now, all this leaves me to say, what's the role of a constitution in all this? Well, the constitution is the framework within which both the legal and political, to some extent actually economic system, operate. So the constitutional law, written constitution, or what you have in the United Kingdom, an unwritten constitution, but very strong conventions, set the framework within which both the legal and political system operate. As a result of which, of course, a constitution is quite difficult to change. Pretty much every legal system that I know requires a two-thirds majority in the legislation, which for those purposes either in real terms or symbolic terms, becomes the Constitutional Assembly, or the Constitutive Assembly, both terms are used. In its original form, of course, the Constitutional Assembly writes the Constitution, well, actually, specialists write the Constitution, and the Constitution, of course, overrides all other legal considerations. But what is the Constitution based on? Well, notionally, it's the will of the people. This is a bit vague. It's a bit airy-fairy. So in fact, what not all, but most European constitutions, I've looked through, I'm not saying every European constitution, there's a very large number of them, but I've looked through about 15 or 20. And without exception, they say the highest norm is human dignity. In other words, the individual, a human being, whether you derive this from Enlightenment rationality or whether you derive this from Christian proposition that we're all equal in the sight of God, it doesn't really matter. The fact is that there's this concept of human dignity which overrides everything else. And then it becomes a question of interpretation. Can a constitutional court override, throw out, quash legislation in the name of human dignity? The German constitutional court says absolutely yes. The Hungarian constitutional court, with which I have had dealings, I know their work moderately well, says in principle yes, but they're very cautious. So we don't really know. I honestly don't know what has happened in other jurisdictions, but one assumes that the principle of human dignity operates on this basis. And then it depends on the practice of that constitutional system as to how much regard is paid to it. What I also wanted to mention here is that, well, where does this idea of constitutionality and constitutional courts come from? Constitutionality, I think, goes back a long way. In a way, it goes back to the medieval period when the barons, the aristocracy, tell the ruler, well, your power isn't absolute. You may rule by divine right, that's to say, because of God has invested you with this power. To be precise, we have crowned you, but there are certain limits to your power. You can argue that this is the beginning of constitutionality, which in Europe, in Europe of Western Christianity, also had to pay regard to the papacy, the religion, the power of the church. And without going into great long detail, by the 20th century, after the First World War, the idea that there should be a particular court which deals only with constitutionality comes into being, first of all, in Austria. The person whose name you should all be familiar with is Hans Kelsen. He founds the first constitutional court in Europe, 1921 or two, I'm open to correction, in Austria. And basically he argues that the constitutional court in Austria has the right to override legislation. There's a big argument between the German, really rather right-wing constitutionalist Carl Schmitt and Kelsen in 1932, Hans Schmitt saying in certain circumstances supreme power should be in the hands of the ruler, Kelsen saying no, it should be in the hands of a constitutional court. I think that particular tension is still there. So basically, constitutional courts are set up after the Second World War. There are one or two exceptions. There's no constitutional court in the Netherlands. A chamber of the Supreme Court performs this function, similar in Estonia, but basically there's constitutional jurisdiction, which then raises the question, of course, how are the judges chosen? Huge variety. Is it chosen by parliament? Is it chosen by president? Or there's this nice little touch in Finland where the Minister of Justice recommend somebody who is then nominated by the President. I don't think the distance there between politics and law is all that great, but, you know, that's open to argument. So, two other points. Is there such a thing as a constitutional court overstepping its boundaries? This is known as the ultra vires, ultra vires, beyond its powers principle. Terribly difficult. If the constitutional court is the supreme authority on legality, can it bring in a judgment which goes beyond that legality? It's more than just a philosophical or metaphysical question. It's a very real question. And in some jurisdictions, it's very clear that in these circumstances, the constitutional court has to ask, basically, Parliament to bring in a constitutional amendment. This has happened in various jurisdictions. The German constitutional court, which I think is the most interesting and certainly the most powerful constitutional court in Europe, adds to this that there's a so-called eternity clause, which simply cannot be changed. The Hungarian constitutional system does not have this, but I've asked constitutional judges, what about it? And they say, well, we don't know. Will it happen? It may happen. We don't know. So an eternity clause is something that can never be changed. Like, for example, insisting that the political system is democratic, issues of this kind. My final area is, there are two actually, which sort of overlap. I'll deal with the first one fairly briefly. There's a range of literature around which says judges are beginning to take too many political decisions. The term is used as juristocracy, rule by judges. And there's some truth in this. In a lot of jurisdictions, judges are required to take political decisions, of their own accord. I was in Canada talking to the Supreme Court judges, and a very interesting meeting with one of them who said, look, the problem for the Constitutional Court in Canada, Supreme Court, is that they know that their decisions must both be legal, that's to say, within the frame of legality, but also legitimate, be acceptable to a great majority of the population. If this is followed, then the juristocracy problem doesn't really arise. It can do, because what is happening at the same time is that politicians are outsourcing judgments to the courts, because it's easier. There are difficult political decisions to be making, so we'll dump it in the lap of the constitutional court. Now, this brings me to my final topic, which is a juristocratic topic, the problem of the European Union. The European Union has its own constitutional court, the European Court of Justice in Luxembourg. I'll call it the Luxembourg Court. And the Luxembourg Court declared quite a long time ago, I think in the 1960s, that in EU legal matters, it has supreme power. The only way that can be changed is changing the EU treaties, which basically is pretty close to impossible. 27 member states all have to agree. It may happen in the coming years. But at the moment, what the Luxembourg Court says is the final word. And there's no accountability. So if you have a democratic system, what happens if the constitutional court in that system, the Luxembourg Court in this instance, is unaccountable? There's no answer to this, except that very recently, last May 2021, the German Constitutional Court declared that a particular decision of the Luxembourg Court was ultra vires. It had stepped beyond its own competence. Well, we don't know what the solution is, but I can see in the future a set of clashes between member state constitutional courts, especially if the Eternity Clause comes into play, and the Luxembourg court saying, no, say the member state court, this goes too far. I don't know what will happen, but that, I would say, is one of the big issues in the forthcoming years. So thank you for listening to me. That's all I have to say about rule of law. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.